Hello everyone. So before we get started, I'm going to do some introductions. So hello and welcome to the 6:30 block of Queer Talk presentations. My name is Richard from the LGBT Resource Center, and I will be the facilitator. So before I introduce you to your presenter, I want to remind you guys of the guidelines of conduct and conversations we set for Queer Talk. That's on your brochures, and that the present that Buddha. Reading is hard, and the presenters are not required to answer any questions if they don't want to. Also, if you need to leave at any time, the auditorium near the entrance of the Honors College is open for reflection and rest, and the session is going to be live streamed. So now let me introduce you to Kiara Holder. Kiara uses she or they pronouns and will be giving Gaze in Space. I feel like I need to do this. Gaze in Space, right? The importance of LGBT representation in science fiction. Trigger warnings include mention of homophobia, guns, and bury your gaze trope. Printouts of either their presentation or notes are available for anyone who needs them. So, take it
away. All right. Hi, everybody. Nice to meet you. I'm Kiara.
Like I said, oh no, I lost my presentation.
Wow.
The man is shutting me down already.
Okay.
But, like I said, I'm Kiara. This is Gaze in Space. Designed in part because when I realized that I could say the phrase gaze in space in all seriousness and put it on my resume, I could not resist, and I could not stop myself. But also because I'm passionately serious about nerdism in science fiction and the fact that we really, really need to have LGBT representation in science fiction. So let's get started. So first, I like to have a roadmap so you guys kind of know where I'm going to touch on. Representation, sci-fi, representation in sci-fi. Why does it matter? The importance of role models, the importance of visualizing the future, challenging the concept of forced diversity, and then support diverse science fiction, because this is all a big plug-in to get you guys to all watch things that I like. That's the truth. Next. So I love quotes. I usually challenge people to read the quotes, but I can also read the quotes. This is a long quote, so I'll read this one, because it's a lot. The more I write stories, this is from Paolo Bassagalupi. This is a sci-fi writer and a young adult fiction writer. The more I write stories for young people and the more young readers I meet, the more I'm struck by how much kids long to see themselves in stories, to see their identities and perspectives, their avatars, if you will, on the page, not as issues to be addressed or as icons for social commentary, but simply as people who get to do cool things in amazing worlds. Yes, all of the issue books are great and have a place in literature, but it's a different and wildly joyous gift to find yourself on the pages of an entertainment, experiencing the thrills and chills of a world more adventurous than our own. So, when I read this quote, I was like, wow, that's like literally my entire life story, trying to find myself in books, and trying to find myself in books that weren't just about being black and gay and sad. Wow. I really love it when I can find books that aren't about those things, because I already am all of those things. And I like it even more now that I'm an adult, because children's literature is getting more and more diverse, and adult fiction isn't. And that's part of what inspired me to do this presentation. Because we need to challenge people to not just say that diversity belongs in children's literature. It belongs in all literature, especially science fiction. Next slide. So representation. Representation has two definitions, but we're focusing on the second. The description or portrayal of someone or something in a particular way, or as being of a certain nature. In this case, that nature is in the LGBT community, and hopefully in science fiction as well. I didn't mention this at the beginning because I'm trash, but in all honesty, if anyone has questions or needs me to slow down because I talk fast, especially when I'm in front of a crowd, please let me know. I am happy to answer any and all questions. I don't really have like a brain-to-mouth filter, so I'm happy to answer anything at all, really. Next slide. So why does this matter? Why does representation matter? Why does science fiction matter? Why does any of it matter? So. This is like one of my fundamental beliefs, why I love talking about science fiction and fiction and anything at all. I love talking. Our consumption of media really shapes fundamental aspects of our understanding of the world and the people around us. particularly aspects of life that do not apply to ourselves or those around us. If we never see something or we aren't something, it may as well not exist for all that we understand about it. So, what we see in media, therefore, exposes us to who we are not and who is not around us. This is especially true through televised, cinematic, and print media, books, movies, TV, the radio. What we see has an impact on us because what we see shapes how we understand the world. What I saw when I was a child deeply impacted what I thought was possible and who I thought I could be and what I thought I could not be. And so, if the only images that exist of LGBT people that exist in the media are those of undignified stereotypes, of predatory villains, of miserable loners, wow, miserableness. How many films are there about LGBT people where we're alive and happy at the end? Ooh, the struggle is real. I've been watching the same 13 movies for a long time. That it makes it that much more difficult for real LGBTQ people to exist and envision happy futures for themselves and to be understood in general. So many of my friends thought they understood my experience because they were like, oh my god, you're like Santana in Glee. And I was just like, who? What? Why? That was a bit of a panic. But it matters because as much as we might all like to believe ourselves to be better than getting our ideas and understanding of the world from fiction, we're really not. Fiction and watching TV and what we see on the news, that all shapes how we understand the world because we can't put ourselves in other people's shoes unless we see their lives. And the only lives we see for ourselves end in us dying on TV at the end of the season because they built up all the gay tension for that one kiss and then killed us off so they didn't have to deal with the backlash. Wow, bury your gays much. Next slide. So it matters. And then from Isaac Asimov, who is widely considered the father of science fiction, not really, that was actually Mary Shelley who wrote Frankenstein, the very first science fiction novel. Individual science fiction stories may seem as trivial as ever to the blinder critics and philosophers of today, but the core of science fiction, its essence, the concept around which it resolves, has become crucial to our salvation if we are to be saved at all. Science fiction, in and of itself, is about the future. It is a form of speculative media that involves exploring concepts of futuristic science and visions of what the future could be. Science fiction has led to science fact. What we see, does anyone recognize that in the corner over there? That's a communicator from Star Trek. That is a cell phone. I kid you not, I was looking up inventions that were inspired by science fiction. And first of all, the guy who invented the first cell phone said, when I watched Star Trek, I didn't see a vision, I saw a goal. And that was what inspired them to create the cell phone. But even beyond things, the very first submarine was inspired because someone read books about under the sea. And they were like, wow, I can do that. The helicopter. All kinds of amazing inventions came from science fiction because what we saw, we thought we could create. What we become inspired by, we create. What we see, we become inspired by. And the more that we see and create, the more that we envision and change the world around us. And the future is us, because science fiction as a genre, like I said, it's about what the future is and about what it may hold. Sci-fi exists to expand upon our hopes and our fears and our dreams and all of these things and say, I don't know the future, but this is what I want it to be. Or this is what I don't want it to be in the case of some very, very serious science fiction novels. But it's about what we are and what we want, and it has tangible impacts upon the real world. More than simply deserving to be seen, though, LGBT people deserve to be in science fiction because we belong in that vision of the future. We aren't just a part of it. We are the future. I am the future. You are the future. We are all the future. And it's not just about, I deserve this. It's, no, I am here. And if you are envisioning a future where you can't, where if you're envisioning sci-fi and you say, I just didn't see LGBT people there, it's like, wow. I was down the street, bro. I'm right here. I have been here. I will be here in the future. I might not be here in 2600 when hopefully this is all behind us, but someone will be here and they will still be a lesbian and they will probably still be a hot mess like I am. Oh, wait, go ahead. To the right, if you see here, this is Sally Ride, and this is proof that the future is us and that we belong in sci-fi because Sally Ride was the first American woman in space. And as we found out after her death in 2012, she was also the first LGBT person in space. She and her partner outed her after her death because she felt it was important to share that aspect of her life. She was such a private person. Mm-hmm. But when people say that LGBT people don't belong in sci-fi, we are science fiction. We are the future, and we are the past now, too, because we went into space already. Examples of representation. Oh, man. Okay. I'm going to date myself. I'm going to also acknowledge that I didn't watch all of these shows, and I desperately went to all of my friends, and I was like, please. Please tell me. I need my little gay hands need to know what is happening. So these are all characters from science fiction shows and comics and books. I don't remember all of their names at the moment, but to the far left, to the far left is Ianto Jones and someone from Torchwood, and they had one of the don't judge me this way.
Captain Jack,
there you go. Ugh, I didn't really like that show too much. But I acknowledge its importance because this was one of the first gay kisses on popular British science fiction ever. Wow. And it's still one of the only ones, unfortunately. In the middle, we have Selena, I think that's how you pronounce it. She's from Firefly, and she's an LGBT character, an unfortunate sometimes character, because she's a sex worker who isn't given a lot of necessarily respect in the show, because wow, the way that we view and value sex workers is horrible in fiction and in reality. But she exists, and she in her brief appearance on Firefly, bless you, Firefly, she worked with both men and women because she did not see a difference, and she valued both of them. But she talked about how she felt a different connection with women than she did with men, and wow, I can relate. We have Bill Potts, who's the most recent of these characters. She is the most recent companion on Doctor Who, and she is a black lesbian, and I started watching Doctor Who again after 5 years because I was like, wow, I don't even care why you did this. All I care is that you did this. And throughout the season, she has this amazing growth, and who she is as a character is just a part of who she is as a person. She goes on amazing science fiction adventures, and she's gay. And it's not a special episode. It's just, wow, beautiful. She's gay. And my personal favorite on this list at the very far left at the bottom is Emily, also known as Tracer. She is the leading character in Overwatch, which is a first-person shooter video game. It's an incredibly popular game that has millions of players worldwide, and she's a lesbian. She's on the cover of all of their games. She's on the front page. She's the first leading character in their animated shorts, and she's a lesbian. And I was just like, Blizzard, I would give you my life right now. Because all it mattered to me is that all of those awful people online who said all these horrible things, all Blizzard had to say is, she's gay. She's gay. It's real. But these are so few examples, and there are more. I found a few more. But so many times, they die. Because, wow, our world just doesn't really want to believe that we can live. But they existed, and these characters existed. Next slide. And the fact that they existed is critically important to, one, the fact that I'm still here in this room right now, and the fact that many of us might still be here in this room, or are here, or have gone, or will exist in the future, but also because of role models. So this is where I'm going to go into my my student affairs, my student development theory side, my master's degree, because there is a concept of social influence, and particularly that concept is revolves around the concept that people act and believe and think because of influences upon them. And it doesn't matter, imaginary or absent, meaning that someone could have died, someone could be known, or they could just be a character. People act, and those people existing influence our actions by shaping how we experience events, our interpretation of those events, and the meaning we attach to them. So, role models are so critically important because where we cannot see ourselves, we can see others, and those others can pull us up and help us live and breathe and exist. And for me, science fiction is so important for that because science fiction is about the future. It isn't about, I could have existed, it's about, I can still exist. I still have reason to be. I still have reason, I still have purpose. You have purpose. I will have an impact in the future because I will live and breathe, and when I die, someone will have known that I was here. So, I'm bad at this. I'm sorry. And this is like the most critical example I can think of for science fiction shaping directly science fact. This is Nicole Nichols, who played Miyota Uhura in Star Trek, the original series. And this is Mae Jemison, the first African-American woman in space. This is them posing together because watching her on Star Trek, on television, inspired her to believe that she could be an astronaut. And when I learned that Sally Ride was an astronaut and that she was a lesbian, I didn't think I could be an astronaut because I can't do math. But I knew it was possible that lesbians could be in space, that LGBT people could go to space, and in the future, NASA, one of the biggest science depositories that creates so much of our future on space travel, can be a place where I could have existed if I were good at math. Now we can go to the next one. If we can't write diversity into sci-fi, then what is the point? You don't create new worlds to give them all the same limits of the old ones. I don't write because I want to recreate a world that's sad and depressing and full of racism. I write because I want to see a world where I can be happy and gay and black, and none of those things contradict each other at all, ever. Sci-fi, next slide. Sci-fi is about the future. The future is about us. The future is diverse because we are diverse, because we are many different things. And when we hear pushback from people who say, why are there gay people in Star Trek? What's the point of that? It detracts from the narrative. It detracts from the theme. Challenge that concept, this forced diversity, that we are forcing diversity because it just doesn't happen that way, or it's unrealistic, or the only reason you did this is to appease the people who are demanding and the haters. No. Some statistics. 4.1% of all adults in the U.S. identify as LGBT. 7.3% of millennials identify as LGBT. That's over 10 million people. 19% of people in the United States have a disability. 23% of people in the entire world are Muslim. 49.558% of all people in the world are women. 2% of people in the world are redheads. I have never once watched a show that did not have a redhead. So if we can acknowledge that 2% of the world has red hair, then we can absolutely acknowledge that every single show has no reason to not have an LGBT person. Because I promise you, every time I walk down the street, I see someone else who's gay. I see someone else who is struggling with their gender today. I see someone else who does not look like me. Diversity is real. There is no forced. There's nothing forced about it. What is forced is the concept that all things about the future must be about straight white men who have sadness in their lives. And brown hair. That does seem to be the newest theme. Brown hair, didn't shave today. I promise, there's more people than that. Can you imagine the amount of LGBT representation there might be if there were as many LGBT characters as there are redheads?
Everybody gets a game.
Everybody, but like I just, and it might sound flippant, but I really just imagine a world where every time you flipped on a channel, there was an LGBT character, not because they needed one, but because that's just who there are. Because I can promise you, none of the redheads that I saw, their identity was not red hair. Their identity was, I have red hair and I am a person. I'm a lesbian who likes nerdy things and is kind of a disaster right now. But that's who I am. I could exist. So, the purpose of all this, please support science fiction with LGBT themes. And I say that because currently, right now, according to Netflix and Barnes & Noble and Amazon and a whole lot of retailers ever, LGBT is a genre. And that's really shocking to me because I didn't realize that I was a book that people could pick up and read. I could have sworn that it was a lot more about my life than that. But according to all of these people, the thought is genres are a way to distinguish the primary audience: young adult, Christian, women's fiction, African American, gay. But the other says that genre is defined by setting and thematic content. LGBT characters and exploring identity are not inherently genre fiction. We are more than our issues, and we deserve to be in science fiction not as the gay character, but as the captain and medic and the person who really hates space and wishes they were on Earth, but they had medical bills to pay, so they're in space.
That's
And as kind of like an example of supporting that fiction, this is a trailer for a film that came out in 2015 called Credence. It's a indie-developed film that was paid for through contributions globally from people who were like, I really want to see this movie made. And it's available on Vimeo if you want to buy it. It's like
$6. Final exams week, and that means two things. The library is packed, and I'll be writing papers.
Exams
week. Right? There we go.
I never got to say goodbye. What did you tell her?
Fiction film about the apocalypse and humanity destroying the Earth, not because the main characters are a married gay couple and their child. It isn't sad because someone wants to take their kid away because they're gay, or because one of them got fired because they're gay, or because X, Y, and Z happened because they're gay. It's sad because these are people going through the most stressful event that we hope never happens in the real world. And that meant so much to me. As someone who loves to cry at sad movies, to not be crying because of something that could happen in my real life, hopefully. Fingers crossed. So, this is my last slide, and then I open it up to discussion. I'm sorry if I went really fast, I'm bad at that. But these are some big science fiction things to me, and I wanted to share them. So, Ancillary Justice is a book that means a lot to me, and I'm still reading it. It's a series that's finished, though. It's a trilogy called The Imperial Rush, and it takes place in the future, in space. The main character would consider herself to be a trans woman, and she is from a world where all people use female pronouns, or at least what she defines as female pronouns, and so everyone that she interacts with, she mislabels at times, and other times doesn't. And they have this conversation, and it's so natural in the world. I read this book and I almost cried, because on the third page, they were talking about gender, and oh right, I have to remember to use people's pronouns. What are your pronouns? And every romance interaction that happens in this series, the vast majority of them are LGBT. But it's not about LGBT, it's about the fact that the main character was kicked out of the Empire and wants to dismantle the Empire because it's an awful place. And they're going through the struggles of, wow, my entire worldview is shaped incorrectly because of this predominantly, this negative interaction that I had with the world that believes that we are the best and superior and that we should spread that and colonize and conquer other nations. And that was so impactful to me. It is also impactful to me because almost all of the characters are brown. And they talk about that. They talk about how it's strange in their world to see people who aren't brown like them. And how it's odd, and how they have different kind of gender norms. And I was like, wow, I'm not being othered in this book. Wow, you're having the same experience. Okay, we're having this experience. This is who we are, and it's so fun to read. Sometimes dense, but really fun because there's sci-fi battles, and there's science booms, and there's weird science. And I'm like, does that work? I don't care if it doesn't work. It might work in the future. And I read it and I plug it. It's won a lot of awards, so it's not just that I think it's good. It's that a lot of people globally thought it was like, wow, you deserve this award and that award and that award too. And here's a fourth one just for kicks. And so, but if you don't want to spend money, because that's real, who has money? Always Human is a webcomic that's complete. I double checked, but I was like, is it complete? And it's set in the future about. And it's in a future where everyone can modify their bodies however they want and look different, and feel different, sound different, change their hair every day if they want to change their physical features. And in that world, a girl sees another girl who doesn't change herself, who chooses to look, well, who looks the way she does naturally. And she's so inspired by what she sees as bravery to be who I was without the artifact of change. And she kind of falls in love with her, and at the same time this other girl falls in love with her, and she's envious because she can't change who she is, but she kind of wishes she could. And together they muddle through what it means to want to change and also not want to change and be who I am authentically. And I was just reading it and looking at the art, and I was like, you're free and you're gay. And the concept of being able to instantly change your appearance is so uniquely gratifying when you're stuck in your body, that I was just enthralled. Gotta plug it. And then if you're a TV person, Star Trek, of all things, Star Trek finally has an important gay character. And I say important because it isn't a scene in the newest Star Trek movie that you could blink and miss. It's an actual character and his actual family, and he actually does things that aren't related to being gay or that aren't just blink and miss. It's, I'm gay, this is my family, this is the space job that I have, I guess. And that is so fun to see in Star Trek, which to most people is still the godfather of all things space. I think that's my last slide.
Yes.
It's my last slide. I thank you for being an audience. I'm always open to questions. I can plug other shows and things, especially things that aren't science fiction too, because I love all things, not just science fiction. But science fiction is so important.
Would it be okay if I email you and we can exchange webcomics?
Yes.
Because I need that in my life.
Please. I'm always happy to plug webcomics. The only ones I read are ones that are full of gay characters.
Same.
If I have to read it, if I can read it for free, it's going to be gay. If I have to pay money, it better be gay, but I can't always get that in my life. But so, I hope I didn't waste your time, and I hope you all enjoyed this, and I'm glad you guys are such a great audience, and I had this opportunity. I love media. I think it's one of the most important critical things that we don't have control of in our lives, but could exercise more control of. And I always encourage everyone. These are three things, and I put three different forms of media because sometimes people don't like to watch TV, sensory issues, sometimes they do. Sometimes people don't like webcomics, sometimes people don't like books. Feel it. I haven't read Bitch Planet, so I didn't want to plug it, but it's good. My ex loves it, and the only reason I haven't read it is because we really offered to ask her if I could borrow it. After we broke up. In the back, and then you?
Another webcomic thing about plugging. It's called Oh Human Star. It's it's still updating. It's not finished yet, but it's a webcomic, sort of futuristic. Not, I would call it sci-fi, but it's not about space. Like the story's sort of told in two parts. There's like an inventor and his assistant who fall in love, and then Mr. Inventor, spoilers, and then 16 years later, like Mr. Inventor wakes up, and now it's like this like robot world, and how to deal with his boyfriend, who's now it's like it's been 16 years, and there's transgender characters. And it's good.
That sounds interesting. I love robots.
Yeah.
just wanted to say that was a really fantastic presentation. Can we give like a hand, please? Like, you guys are great.
I'm just gonna plug things. Wow, the Wicked plus the Divine is a really good constant series that's updating frequently. It's an independent. It's not necessarily sci-fi. It's kind of sci-fi. It's more of a space thing that's happening in a world that's really cool. It's got a lot of LGBT characters, a lot of people of color characters, a lot of all kinds of characters, and they're all kind of dealing with magic and mysticism and breaking up and fighting. And wow, except for that third thing breaking up, all of those other things are really great. Okay, I'm done. I'm gonna stop plugging things shamelessly.